Hello, my name's Lindsay Turnbull and I'm an Associate Professor in the Department of Plant Sciences at the University of Oxford. And we're right in the middle of this very serious coronavirus crisis right now. And my students are all stuck at home and we want to keep them in touch with biology and keep them in touch with us. And so we're going to make a new series of videos and they're going to be called Back Garden Biology. Hello and welcome to Back Garden Biology. Now sometimes on Back Garden Biology we have a mystery to solve and they're often my favourite episodes. And there's two that I did last year that I can remember quite vividly. In the first one I wandered down my road to the kids' playground and there were these large poplar trees growing there. And at the bottom of the trees were these quite large holes, very distinctive, very low to the ground, and I didn't know what had made them. And I then did a bit of research and found out that something, the thing that might have made them, might be about to emerge from the holes. And I went and did a stakeout, and sure enough, I found these wonderful hornet moths, which were emerging from the holes. And they live underground as caterpillars and they feed on the roots of the trees, and they were quite incredible insects. So that was the first mystery I solved. Well, actually, that was the second one, because prior to that, I'd found something even closer to home, which was in my lawn. I had found these little volcano-shaped mounds, just single holes, rather neat and tidy, and I staked those out as well, and I found that they were being made by a solitary bee called the ashy mining bee. And there are lots of these solitary bees in Britain. They don't all nest underground. You probably know you can have a bee hotel and they can nest in those too. But they're mostly going out collecting pollen from flowers, provisioning their nests. They're making balls of pollen, which they then lay their eggs on. The larvae then hatch and eat the pollen, and so the next generation is born. So that was two mysteries I had and solved. Now I've got a third mystery for you. If I just have a look down here now, I ask my cameraman to pan down to the lawn, you can see that once again there are holes in my lawn. And if I just show you here, they are big holes, big, messy, untidy holes. And there are several of them in this area here, and I just noticed them when I was on my way to the compost heap the other day, and I thought, who's been making those holes? Of course, your first thoughts when you've got big untidy holes in your lawn always turns to the squirrel, right? The grey squirrel is very familiar to all of us in Britain, and I know I've seen them digging holes in the lawn and burying conkers. The next door neighbours here have a larger horse chestnut tree at the bottom of the garden, and they love burying them all over the place. But they're actually quite tidy squirrels and they normally cover them over quite nicely, whereas this, whoever's making these holes, just doesn't care who else finds them. So that's going to be today's mystery. Who is making these great big messy untidy holes in my lawn? Right, the first thing I'm going to do is tell you a little bit about my lawn. I mean, to be honest, I hesitate to call it a lawn because that implies something quite grandiose and manicure that you could perhaps play croquet on. Whereas, well, I've got grass really. I've got heavy clay soil here and a very kind of uneven surface, because that's the nature of clay. When you step on it, you compact it very easily. If things are burrowing and tunnelling in it, then they push it out. So it's incredibly uneven. And then actually, me and my partner, when we moved into the house 7 years ago, wanted to kind of rewild the garden a little bit. We want to invite as much nature in as we possibly can. And one of the things we decided to do was to leave some of the lawn unmown. We've got a long, thin garden, like lots of gardens in Britain. And if you're in a semi-detached house or a terraced house, you've got a long, thin garden. And we thought we'd leave big stretches of the lawn unmown. So this whole strip is unmown. And this is what it looks like in the summertime, because it looks very nice. You've got long grass that's flowering and you can have flowers growing in the lawn. It's quite difficult to get wildflowers to establish in the lawn, but gradually they do come in actually. You can seed them in yourself and plant things in, and you can also just wait to see what happens, and it's amazing what turns up in the lawn. Now, because we're not mowing it, that also allows other things to really enjoy themselves in the lawn. And if we just have a look down here, this is a bit like the thing I was filming at the beginning with the mystery. You can see there's very clearly a mound here. And perhaps you're thinking it's a molehill. Well, it's not a molehill. I don't have moles in the garden. But you can see there's a telltale hole in this one as well. And actually, if I went along this strip of lawn here now, this unmown strip, I could find many of these mounds, and every one of them would have at least one telltale hole in the top. So what we need to do is to find out what is it that's making these mounds in the lawn. And in order to find that out, I'm going to get my trowel and do a bit of digging. Okay, so here I am, my trowel in hand. This is quite a big mound that's grown in this at different parts of the lawn, but you can really see how it's sticking off the ground. And I'm going to try and raid this mound to see if we can find out what's here. Nothing yet. It's been obviously incredibly cold, and it might be that I have to dig hard. Now, can you see that on the surface? Can you see those little orange insects? They're moving very slowly because it's cold. And, you know, their movements will be, and their energy that they have is related to the temperature. And I hope you can see that they are ants, but not little black ants, which you might be more familiar with seeing. I'm going to just cover them over and push their mess back together. Feel a little bit guilty about that, but there we are. So in gardens, ants are incredibly common, and you're probably aware of them if you have a garden, but you might be more familiar with these little black ants, and here you can see them all swarming out of my front garden. They nest actually in the mortar gaps in between the paving stones, or we have this sort of path built, and they come swarming out every now and then. I'm not sure what they were doing at this point in time, because they weren't producing reproductives, which is sometimes when you suddenly see loads of ants, is when the reproductives come out, the new queens and males that the colonies produce at the end of the summer. You can get enormous quantities of flying ants. I bet we've all seen those. But anyway, so the black ants are the ones you see more commonly, and that's because they come above ground a lot more. Those little yellow ants, and they're called the yellow meadow ant, doesn't really come above ground at all. And so you might wonder, well, what's it doing and what's it feeding on then? Well, if you're a gardener, one of the things that you won't like very much in your garden are aphids, like these little black bean aphids that are feeding on my philadelphus in my front garden. They're a real pest of plants, right? They come, an initial individual comes, they can then reproduce asexually, and before you know it, your favourite plant is absolutely smothered in aphids. And then sometimes what comes along are these little black ants. And they, what we call, milk the aphids or farm the aphids. And how do they do that and why do they do that? Well, it's because aphids stick their stylus into the phloem of the plant, and that's the pipes that conduct the sugar in the plant. And it's under pressure, so they just stick their pipe in and the sugary solution just comes out into their gut. But it's not actually a very good diet, it's just sugar, there's no protein there. So they have to process very large quantities of it, and out the other end of the aphid comes a sugar solution, all the excess sugar that they don't want and they actually excrete, and that attracts ants. So ants are there taking the excess sugar from the plant that the aphid didn't want, and in return the aphid gets some protection from the ants. The ants will actually protect the aphids against predators. So to some extent you might say that the ants could be considered the enemy of the gardener because they're sort of helping the aphids out, but otherwise ants really don't do any harm. Now, what are these guys doing then? Because you don't see them above ground, what are they feeding on? Well, incredibly, there are also aphids that feed on the roots of plants, and especially on things like clover, which my lawn is absolutely full of. And these ants are going about under your lawn and they are milking, farming the aphids that are feeding on the roots of plants, which is truly incredible. And it's actually a very common ant throughout Europe, this yellow meadow ant, and it makes these really big mounds. And these mounds can be up to 1 meter high and 100 years old. So if you go to an ancient chalk grassland, for example, they're absolutely covered in these great big mounds. And leave them alone if they're in your garden. You know, they're actually really good for the soil because they're making all these tunnels underneath the ground which aerates your lawn. You know, soggy, waterlogged soil is really the enemy of the lawn, not the ants. But of course, if you're mowing every week, they won't be able to make their hills properly. So as soon as you stop mowing or you reduce the frequency of mowing, then you see them more often. Now we know what's in the mounds. It's the great big nests of the yellow meadow ant, but that still doesn't answer the question of who's making the holes in their mounds. That's what we've got to come to in the last part of this video. Okay, so we're back where we started. This is the old apple tree, and just in front of it we had all those massive untidy holes in the lawn, and I didn't know who was making them. Now what I did think, because apart from the grey squirrel, is that it's probably a bird, right? And maybe it's magpies. This is film that I took in the summer of two magpies hunting about in the lawn. They're often in the long grass in the summer looking for things, and they do seem to be putting their beaks into the lawn to get things, so maybe it was magpies. I thought, well, I didn't know, and I thought I'd put this up. So this is a camera trap which I got myself last year, and I put this up against the tree, pointing at the holes in the lawn to see if I could trap the culprit. Obviously not really trap it, but just get some film of it. And this is what I saw. Now this is a green woodpecker. And obviously that's massively exciting. Green woodpeckers eat ants, and pretty much only ants. They need to eat about 2,000 ants every day. And so, you know, if you are kind enough to leave your lawn some space for the ants, then you could be providing food for the green woodpecker, which is a really, really exciting bird. And the brilliant thing about feeding green woodpeckers is I don't have to pay for the food. It's not like buying those dried mealworms for the blue tits. They're quite expensive. All you have to do is not mow your lawn quite as often. To be honest, my partner's really happy about that I'm not sending him out every weekend to mow the lawn. It looks nice in the summer, and you can just let the ants go. They don't come into your house, by the way. You won't find them in your kitchen. They will stay in your garden. They're milking aphids underground that you never even see. But in winter, they can attract in this most brilliant of birds. Now, if we look again at this footage a bit speeded up, you can see how nervous this woodpecker is. It's got its head up and down all the time looking for predators. It's one of the few green birds in the UK. It's this amazing vivid green, which I presume is camouflage. If it's feeding on the ground all the time, it's going to be at risk from aerial predators, you know, birds of prey. And so it's really beautifully camouflaged there, but it's constantly looking around, and it never comes any nearer the house than this. This is where I always see it feeding, right at the other end of the garden, but it won't come near the house. Okay, so that's it for this week on Back Garden Biology. I hope I've encouraged you to think this year about rewilding your garden. It doesn't mean letting it become a massive bramble patch, which you can barely fight your way through anymore. It means doing some simple things and leaving strips of unmown lawn to encourage invertebrates and the things that feed on them is one of the really important things that you can do. Okay, finally, of course, we are in this awful lockdown right now, and the government and NHS are reminding us, please try not to leave your house. So that means, you know, if you're lucky enough to have a garden, get out in it. But if you don't and you're going out and about, just be careful. Don't get too close to people. Stay safe, and see you next time on Back Garden Biology.